again and welcome back. If you are new around here, then hi, nice to meet you. And if you're returning, thank you very, very much for coming back. This is going to be your weekendly, who are we fucking kidding right about now? Yeah, I do have a little bit of sweariness in me. If you don't like that, I'm sorry. If you clicked on here thinking, thought this was meant to be a nice skincare video, my apologies. It will be a skincare video, don't worry. This is your weekly Saturday, Sunday skincare video. Didn't do it last weekend either. Again, just work has been knocking my absolute pan in. I have really been struggling with being back at like full-time work. And for anybody out there who's thinking, ah, COVID, you know, it's gone and done, it's very good. No, it's fucking still most definitely here. And the hospitals are only getting busier. Not with COVID, but it is still there. But the hospitals are just back to as busy as they were before. I see the winter coming. I think it's going to be even harder. Total tangent there. But work has been tough. So I wasn't putting one up last weekend. My apologies for that. This one is going to be all about niacinamide. Now, I think this is a very well-known product now. It isn't actually a new drug or a new product as such. Like, it has been around for a very long time. But again, it's one of these buzzwords. It's one of these things that is in skincare now and it's like in absolutely everything. So I thought I would give this its own video. I am going to try and give peptides their own video as well and possibly retinol as well. I am doing a new retinol routine. I'm probably going to leave that for a few more months before I can actually give you my proper opinion on it. And once I've kind of done them, I think I'll just try and tie in all the other random pieces of shit that's on the Ordinary website and just be like miscellaneous items, because where else are we going to go from here? If there is anything else that you'd like to see me talk about or you've had any experiences or anything, then please comment below. Go down, subscribe, like, whatever, follow me on Instagram. All the shit is down below or flying about the screen right now. But otherwise, let's get started. So niacinamide, what is it? Vitamin B3, I believe. Vitamin B3 can be found in like dietary intake such as kind of meat, greens, nuts, oats. What else is it in? Liver? I know liver's not, that's not everybody's cup of tea. I personally love a bit of Totties, onions and liver. I'm kind of old school like that. Anybody who's vegan watching this, absolutely squirming in their seat right now. I'm really sorry. I am a meat eater. You can also get it from the likes of milk and tea and coffee too, just so you know. So we do get it in our dietary intake, and it is also a water soluble vitamin, which means that if we get a buildup of it, I think it's 35 milligrams in our daily allowance we should have within our body of niacinamide. And if we have too much, if we say, let's say we had 45 grams, the other 10, grams, like you're just fucking swallowing spoonfuls of niacinamide. 45 milligrams of niacinamide in our body and we only need 35, then that other 10 will be excreted via our urine. We will piss it right out. There are lots of benefits to niacinamide. Also, you might have heard of niacinamide being named as nioxin or nicotinic acid or nicotinamide as well. The only thing I would say is that nioxin and niacinamide are slightly different. Nioxin is something that you would take in like a supplement. You would take supplements of it and then it is kind of converted into niacinamide. And again, if there is any excess buildup from the nioxin, like, you know, you take like loads of nioxin pills and your body thinks, I only need 35 milligrams of this once I've converted it, you will pee it out. Now, one of the other things that I mentioned there was nicotinamide or nicotinic acid. I hope I'm saying that right. Nicotinic acid. Yeah, sorry, I had to check that there. Nicotinic acid. Sometimes, I think like a while ago, people, when niacinamide started to become the hype thing, people said they were using it and finding that they were causing a lot of redness and irritation on the face. I think nicotinic acid is actually something that is prone to make people have flushing, like flushing on your skin. The only thing that makes me do that is red wine. I'm not gonna lie, have a couple of brewskis and you're like right red face. But nowadays most compounds are made into niacinamide rather than nicotinic acid. So that is something that doesn't happen as regularly, although I'm not going to say that it definitely won't. Know your own skin, know what you're putting on, and if you've had reactions to this before and you don't like it, that's absolutely fine. So what are the benefits for the skin for niacinamide? What do we use it for? Why do we need it? We obviously need it in our body for cell repair and stuff like that, but it's something that, like, for a long time we probably done without. It's also something for a long time that was probably added to products that we didn't even really know about because of its benefits. But that is like a lot of things. A lot of things that I've mentioned throughout this series are actually already in products, and they don't necessarily say, oh, we've got this wonder active ingredient in it. One for example, I'm just going to show you. This is the Boots Glow Brightening Mist. It is not by any means a wonder product, I'm not going to say that. But it says that it's to help skin look hydrated and radiant. Now, one of the kind of top ingredients in this is niacinamide, but absolutely nowhere on the front of the bottle does it claim that it is a niacinamide active product. It just says it's like a glow spray and keeps you radiant. So these products are actively put in a lot of different things and we don't even know about it. So always kind of know what you're putting on your face. Have a little look at the ingredients and think, oh, well, I see things there that I'm kind of like into. I understand what they do and it might be beneficial to my skin. Just make sure you're checking things like that. Niacinamide does have antioxidant benefits and it does help slow kind of free radical production. I do have a video all about antioxidants up here. If you haven't already seen it, then you can go and watch that so I can kind of explain that to you a wee bit more as well. But that is one of the benefits of it. It's quite a large one actually, because nowadays we want that. We want anything that's going to stop kind of free radicals accumulating in our skin and our tissues. With regards to appearance on the skin though, some of the most important things that it helps deal with is redness and irritation, like inflammation, your inflammatory response to these things. I'm not saying it's going to take away your immune system. Before anybody says that, just calm the fuck down. You're not going to put niacinamide on your face and all of a sudden you get the COVID. Don't worry. It also helps reduce sebum. It also helps with transepidermal water loss, so it can act as a kind of moisturizing agent as well. It's said to decrease pore size. I'm kind of on the fence about that one. I don't think there's any obvious evidence to that. It's also said to help with hyperpigmentation, fine lines and wrinkles, and just overall brightening of the skin, making your skin's texture better, making it look a whole lot better. Now, niacinamide is really beneficial to all skin types, but when I first heard about it, it was mainly like it'll help with acne, oh, it'll help with hyperpigmentation. These were like the two main things I kind of heard about, and to be honest with you, I didn't really have a problem with acne, so I didn't really think it was for me. I didn't understand why I would need to use it. It was more the hyperpigmentation side of things that eventually got me interested in it, but it most definitely can be beneficial to all skin types, and I'm just going to break down each of the categories I kind of mentioned there and tell you why actually it's really useful for all of us, and it's actually really beneficial for all of our skin types and doesn't cause that much of an issue in regards to reaction. So as I said, it does help with reducing inflammation, which means it stops any redness or blotchiness that might be caused by acne. When you get like a under the skin pimple or something and then it goes all fiery and red and sore, it helps to kind of calm that down and just ease it down and stop that happening. It helps the inflammation side of things. If you also have something like a rosacea where you've got really red skin, then it would help with that. If you have something like an eczema, then it does kind of two things here. It not only helps because if you with transepidermal water loss, because if you've got broken or itchy skin, then you're more inclined to have that escaping of the you know, you'll get dehydration in your skin because you'll be losing water through the skin. Moisturizing video is up here. I talk about transepidermal water loss and that, if you don't know what the fuck I'm talking about, right there. Basically, it helps with kind of helping the lipid barrier on the top. So we've got redness and inflammation that's caused by maybe an eczema, an acne, or a rosacea. So it helps not only with the redness and blotchiness, but it also helps with the moisturization barrier, like that lipid barrier. It helps increase the production, or helps, I'm going to be honest here, I don't know if it helps to increase the production of ceramides, which are the glue on the top of that lipid barrier. By the way, I do have my nails done today. Off my work for 2 weeks, nurse's priorities right here. So it helps like with the production of ceramides. I don't know if that means it increases it or it just like aids the ceramides that are already in the skin. By doing that, that's keeping that lipid barrier intact, which helps with transepidermal water loss. By doing that, it not only helps hold kind of your moisture in, it might also stop overproduction of sebum. Now, I'm not saying that it's going to like stop sebum altogether. There are some studies to show that it does actually reduce sebum production. But what I can't put my finger on is if it's stopping sebum production because it's stopping the glands going into overdrive and producing too much sebum. So like if you're holding onto your own moisture and stuff like that on top of the skin, the body isn't feeling like I need to produce more oils. I need more moisture in my skin. So I can't put my finger on top of that. I don't know if that is a correlation. Any scientific people, please let me know down below how much of an absolute idiot that I am. Philistine, by all means. But the way I read into it is kind of that was one of the options. And because it also does help with sebum production, and it's, they said it can oil control and all that kind of stuff, then it should also aid with these breakouts that people who have acne have. So therefore, the redness controlled, hopefully less breakouts, but also keeps your skin moisturized, which is good for the people who have the eczema and the rosacea and stuff like that, because the top layer of your skin won't be dried out and there's not breaks in your skin, meaning that you'll not get like stuff going into your skin that shouldn't be there and potentially causing bacteria. And like basically the more sebum you have, then there's a breeding ground for bacteria and you can end up with these breakouts. So that was a very rambly way to say that, but it does like this kind of 3-in-1 magical thing, and actually that's like really beneficial for any skin types, not just for people with acne and not just for people who have dry skin or aging skin. Anybody could benefit from using these. Okay, so minimizing pore size. There isn't any real scientific evidence to say that it does this. You know, like on a cellular level, there's no obvious that this is actually happening. But there are studies to suggest that after people have used it for so many weeks, months, and looked at their skin before and after, that pores seem smaller. Now, the reason for this, we don't know. It's not really obvious as to why physiologically this is occurring. But I have read a few things that people might suggest that because of the kind of reduced sebum, that means that the pores aren't then clogged and stretched, so then they automatically start to shrink a little bit by themselves. The other way to look at it is by improving the skin's texture, by reducing maybe acne breakouts, again, improving the skin texture because there's less bumps and lumps and stuff, means that your skin is looking, and obviously holding onto the moisture as well, is meaning that your skin is looking more dewy, more plump, fresher. So actually maybe the skin overall is just looking nicer. And then therefore people who are looking in the mirror at their skin thinking, God, like my pores are smaller, my skin looks brighter, I look healthier. It might just be the overall appearance that makes people think, oh well, look, my pores have really shrank as well. I genuinely don't know. But just on reading it, I kind of thought it could be either of those reasons. It's not very clear, but there is no scientific evidence to actually suggest that it minimizes pores, like actually shrinks them. And a lot of the time when people claim that, it is normally a marketing term, let's be honest here. Now, one of the reasons why people might say that it's anti-aging is because that it can also help with hyperpigmentation and age spots or sunspots, whatever you want to call them, darkening areas of the skin. Now, the reason this occurs is because niacinamide can help with the transfer between melanocytes to melanosomes to keratinocytes. Again, pronunciation, it is not my strong point, I'm very fucking sorry. I know what I mean in my head. Basically this means like your melanin, that thing again that makes our skin darker or makes people who have darker skin tones, they have more melanin, they have more melanocytes. So it helps with that, it helps kind of put a little break on, it stops that happening. Therefore, it's not so much that it is, you know, bleaching these areas where you maybe have age spots, it's actually almost just stopping the transfer of the things that make them darker. Now, in relation to that, the studies that I've kind of had a little look at and had a little browse at say that this is a slow process. And some of them also say that once you've maybe used niacinamide for like 2-3 months, yes, in those 2-3 months, you might look at your skin and be like, God, look, like my maybe you've got melasma or something like that. Oh, it's like brightened, it's got so much lighter, it looks so much better. But actually, if you continue to use it past those 2 months, then this is never going to get any better than it actually has gotten. I'm not saying that won't stop new ones. So like, I've got obvious like pigmentation going on here from old acne scarring, from old spots, old sores, stuff like that. So I use my niacinamide and things get brighter over the course of 2 months, and I'm thinking, wow, like niacinamide really fucking works. It's amazing. But after that 2 months, some studies suggest that actually it's never going to get any better than that. By continuing to use the niacinamide, I am not going to completely eradicate that. But if I have new spots and new pimples going on and new parts of pigmentation, maybe like sunspots, sun damage, things like that, it should help with them as well. So if you're consistently using it, then it will aid in the lightening and brightening of your skin. Another point to take on board though is that it, as I say, it does take time, but it's normally in conjunction with other things that claim to do this. So maybe an alpha arbutin that is known to help brightening of the skin, even a vitamin C, which we will get to about mixing and layering later, but using it in conjunction with something like a vitamin C that is also known to help brightening and pigmentation, it works more effectively. That's essentially what some of the studies are saying. Now, as I said, with regards to it being like anti-aging, some people might put that down to, sorry, my Kirby grip is falling out my hair there. My hair, it's really getting to the point now that I need it cut because I'm having to pin it up. It's just a fucking riot. The fringe that I cut, now that it's grown out a little bit, I'm not hating. But it's driving me bananas now. I think I'm going to have to bite the bullet, put on a mask and actually go to the hairdressers because it's driving me mad. So as I was saying, with regards to it being anti-aging, people might actually think, well, by minimizing those age spots, that is helping with anti-aging. But with regards to the likes of fine lines and wrinkles, I don't think there's any solid evidence for that. I don't think we can say that niacinamide is definitely going to do that. There are some studies that show they do aid with kind of dermal collagen production. They do aid. I keep saying they, like niacinamide is a they. It really should be an it, shouldn't it? I just realised there, my pronunciation, my grammar, it's all out the fucking window. As I said earlier, if you were coming here for some profesh skincare videos, I'm so sorry to disappoint you. But it can help with some like dermal collagen production, which may help plump the skin and make it look a little juicy. If it's helping with moisturisation as well, it's going to keep you nice and dewy and shiny and like luminescent, hopefully. So you can see why all these things start to tie in, and you can start to see why it's seen as kind of this superhero of skincare at the moment. The other thing to note is as well that maybe increased collagen production can also help with hyperpigmentation. So it's definitely starting to look like it deserves the hype that it's been having lately, I have to admit. So when do I use it, here you say? To be honest with you, I would say you can use it AM and PM. What do the fucking ordinary say? Just to hold on a second here. Yeah, they say morning and evening. The reason I've picked up this one is actually empty. Now this is like, I couldn't tell you how many of these I have bought over the last 3 years. Loads, loads and loads and loads. It wasn't something, as I said already, that I first like thought, oh my god, I need to buy this from The Ordinary, because I thought it was to do with acne and I thought, why do I need this? But once I started using it, again, I wasn't like blown away. I didn't use it and think, wow, that's like a wonder product. I'm so glad I've added it into my skin routine. I just have to be honest with you. The second I stopped using it, I thought, holy shit, what has happened? My skin is not the same. I'm having more breakouts. My skin just wasn't the same. So I think that's something really important to think about. I wasn't blown away by niacinamide when I first used it. The second I stopped using it, I was like, oh my god, where is my niacinamide? Like, why have I stopped using it? And I had to order it again, which means now I have been through like 4 to 5 of these over the past 2.5 years, let's say, because I never bought it when I first started using The Ordinary. But I have consistently bought it over and over and over. You don't have to use the one from The Ordinary only. The one from The Ordinary does have 1% zinc as well, which also helps with sebum production. So if you are specifically looking at it from an acne point of view, this might be one to look at. But obviously, the likes of the Inkey List do one as well. There's fucking hundreds of them out there now. everybody and their granny are on the bandwagon talking about niacinamide. You can get it in moisturizers, as I say, it's in sprays and stuff now, it's everywhere. You can get niacinamide toners, niacinamide treatments, niacinamide face masks, like, it's everywhere now, to be honest with you. But this is the one I particularly normally use. I've actually just ordered the 60ml bottle, so like the double the size one, because I go through it as often as I do. I did want to pick up the Unculus one. I think that it's combined with a hyaluronic acid instead of zinc. And I was really eager to try that, but trying to get your hands on any of this stuff at the moment, I don't know if it's because of the COVID. I'm going to be honest with you, a lot of places aren't like restocking, and that might well be because of the situation in the world at the moment. But I haven't been able to get my hands on a lot of the Unculus stuff. And it's like, if I go into Boots, they've got this, this, and this from the Unculus. And if I go into, not Superdrug, like Cult Beauty or somewhere like that, I can get this, this, and this from the Unculus. But nowhere in the one place. And I am loath to order from like 4 or 5 different places. So I'm just holding out until, yeah, I could go on the Unculus site. But even the Unculus site was out, and I just thought, I can't be arsed, I'm just going to go to the ICM and order again, because I know they've always got their stuff. I've took the Kirby grip out now. It's driving me mad. My hair is driving me mad, I'm sorry. Anyway, so yes, you can use it morning and evening. I personally use mine in the morning. The odd occasion that I will use it in the evening is if I'm going to do retinol that night. The reason being, niacinamide can be paired with things very, very nicely. It doesn't, like, you know, react. It doesn't mean that you don't want to use things like an antioxidant with a water base, because it can destabilize things. You don't want to necessarily use acids with alkaline, like, all that stuff. Niacinamide actually is a very kind of friendly thing, and it can work with most things. You may have heard that vitamin C is a no-go. I personally don't use it with my vitamin C, but it's not because it is necessarily dangerous. I did speak about this in my vitamin C video. I may have spoke about it in my layering video as well. They'll all be here somewhere. But the thing with the vitamin C from the ordinary, especially if you're using the powder one and you use this, it just goes like glue on your hands. It's not an enjoyable experience, and I don't like to do it. So for that reason, I don't mix them together. I don't use them at the same time. But as I was saying, I do use it when I'm going to use a retinol, because this helps with inflammation, it helps with redness, which is sometimes caused, like irritation and kind of flaking and all that kind of stuff can be caused by retinols. And this kind of counteracts that. They work really well together as a bit of a pair. So sometimes I will use it at night if I am going to put on a retinol that night. But generally what I pair it with is my peptides in the morning. I'll get up in the morning, I clean my face, I put my hyaluronic acid on, I put this and some peptide, both in the palm of my hand, and I slather it all over my face. If you do follow me over on Instagram, then you may have seen a couple of IGTV videos with regards to my AM routine, my PM routine. They have slightly changed again, because it's something I consistently do. I'm an absolute skincare addict, what can I say? But I don't mind mixing my peptides and my niacinamide together. It doesn't seem to have any adverse reactions on my skin, and it means it's just kind of a one-stop shop. It means I don't have to layer. I'm just putting a couple of drops of each on my face, and I'm happy with that. Again, I do make sure to layer, you know, leave it 20-30 minutes in between each, because that is the way I like to do my skincare. It's up to you how you want to do yours. You could even take a couple of drops of your niacinamide into your moisturizer and use it that way. You could buy a moisturizer with niacinamide in it. One thing I am going to say is regards to the strengths. I briefly kind of discussed this in one of my previous videos regards to, you know, is percentages now a marketing tool? And I feel like the more I hear about it, the more I feel like it probably is. All of the studies that have been done round about niacinamide are looking at niacinamide in a 2-5% strength. So therefore, why is this 10%? Why are we seeing niacinamides that are 15%, 20%? A lot of, like, there's other studies that suggest that anywhere between 10 and 20 is adequate. There is nothing to suggest at the moment that I have found that anything over 20% is of any benefit, more so than that of a 10 or a 5%. This is a very vague thing to say, but from what I've been reading and what I've been watching, a lot of the information would suggest that we don't really know if using one at 20% is any better than using one at 5%, or using one at 40% is any better than using one at 10%. Like, there isn't obvious kind of data to show that that is true. So therefore, I would say Yeah, pick up the ordinary one. That's the one I've been using, and it was the 10% one that I started at. I think that's the only one they do. They obviously have it in a powder now as well, which we'll get into in a minute. But that is what they are sold at. That is a lot of the ones that I've seen. They're all 10%. So use it if you wish. You can get them in slightly lower strength as from other brands, and if you have experienced any kind of flushing or redness or reactions, then I would say maybe try and dial it down a little bit. Sometimes when you're using it with things as well though, like if you're using your niacinamide with your retinol, just remember it could be that. It doesn't necessarily mean it's the niacinamide, but if you're using it on its own and you realise reaction, then probably either peel it back a bit or go and speak to someone professional, go and speak to a doctor. I think if it was a GP in Scotland, they're going to just be like, well, stop using it then, obviously. But if you can afford to go and see a proper dermatologist or like a skincare clinic, they might give you a little bit more information. Let's be fucking honest here. I suppose one of the questions I have though is like, why are we marketing it? Why are we marketing it higher if we don't actually know if it's any better or not? Who the fuck knows? I think it is absolutely a marketing tool. And as I had just said, The Ordinary have brought out a powder like the 100% L-ascorbic acid, and it is 100% niacinamide powder. As I mentioned before, very, very interesting video from Lab Muffin Beauty. I will just link that here rather than putting the link down below, because I want you to go and watch it. Which basically said, like, well, why are we selling this 100% powder when we don't know if it's beneficial? We don't know if it actually is going to cause more irritation or more damage to the skin. People aren't necessarily going to mix it correctly. And, you know, like, it's not needed. So why are we selling it? Is it marketing? Is it something to make people think, oh, I've got 100%, it's going to work 10 times better? When that, quite frankly, is just not true. So please keep that in mind. With that being said, niacinamide and side effects, the kind of data to kind of say that there's been a lot of them is quite slim. There's not that much to prove. If you are somebody watching this just now and you were like, actually, bitch, I use niacinamide and you know what? My face fucking flared up, didn't like it. I had anaphylaxis. I needed to fucking get my EpiPen out. It was not good. Then that's all right. Tell me I'm a dick. Tell me to shut up. But as far as I know, there is not a lot of research to suggest that people have a lot of kind of allergy reactions, allergens and anaphylaxis, anything like that when they've been using niacinamide. Flushing and redness, yes, that sometimes did occur a little bit more when people were using the niacinic acid, that kind of stuff. I said it at the start of the video. Don't expect me to pronounce things properly twice. But that did occur, and flushing can happen with niacinamide, like more than niacinic acid, but it can occur directly after using and people may experience that, but it should die down. It should just like kind of come and go as quick as it's there, it'll go again. So try and keep that in mind. Like if you use it and you think, God, my face looks really red, but then, you know, half an hour later, or even the morning after, your skin is okay, then it might just be that slight reaction. It doesn't mean to say that your skin is going to become itchy or exaggerated. If you put it on and it's like burning your face off, then yes, of course, wash your face, take it off. If your skin does not like it, that is fine. All I'm saying is that there is not a lot of evidence to say that niacinamide causes a lot of these issues. It is not widely renowned to be an irritant or cause a lot of kind of reactions on the skin, which is really good news. So what I would say is it is an all-round friendly product, and a lot of people will get a lot of benefit from this. I have people that I've spoke to who said, I started using this because I had terrible acne and it has done wonders for my skin. As I say, that's not why I got into it in the first place, but they have said like it has miraculously improved their skin to no end. I'm not going to say it's a one-stop shop. I'm not going to say if you've got like really bad cystic acne, you might still need to go to a doctor and get given proper medication on prescription for that. Absolutely. But go and speak to a specialist. But for the layman, for the likes of me, it has helped with kind of little breakouts that I usually have around about my chin. I feel like I see them a lot less than I'm using my niacinamide. I do feel like my skin feels like plump and moist and juicy. Is that because I use hundreds of other stuff as well? maybe, I can't say it's definitely this, but what I can tell you is I've already said, the minute I stop using this, I just feel like my skin misses it. So I really, really like it. I think it's worth the hype that everybody is talking about at the moment. I think it's like the superhero of skincare at the moment, and I can absolutely see why. So that is it for this one. I hope you've enjoyed that. I hope that gave you some information that you didn't already know. I know niacinamide is a very widely renowned known topic now. I probably am telling you a whole load of shit. What's the hype here? Like, you've not telling me anything. Well, I'm sorry about that. I am a mere mortal. I am not an expert. I have never claimed to be. And I just like having a little ramble about skincare because I really fucking like it. That's the truth. Anyway, the next one I say will probably be peptides, and then I might just put everything else into a kind of miscellaneous ordinary items. Anyway, that's it for now, and I'll see you all again next time. Bye.